Afternoon, everyone. First item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 15221 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the Scottish Election Dates Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Minister Joe Fitzpatrick to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open the debate this afternoon on the general principles of the Scottish Elections Dates Bill. This is a very short and straightforward bill, and I'd like to take the opportunity to set out to the Chamber why it is necessary. As things currently stand, there would be a general election to both the Scottish and UK Parliament elections on the 7th of May 2020. This clash is undesirable for a number of reasons. We know, for example, from our own experience in Scotland in 2007, that holding different elections with different voting systems on the same date can lead to unusually high levels of spoiled and rejected ballot papers. This issue was rightly something of great concern in 2007 and was why Parliament concluded unanimously, in agreement with the Gould report, that different Scotland-wide elections should not be held on the same date. Indeed, the presiding officer wrote to the Secretary of State for Scotland last May, setting out the position she had agreed with all of the main party leaders, that it is imperative that an alternative date for the Scottish Parliament election should be set, as it was in 2011, when our election was moved from 2015 to 2016. She wrote to the Secretary of State, of course, because the power to amend a Scottish Parliament election currently sits with Westminster. And in 2011, it was Westminster, not this Parliament, which legislated to move our elections from 2015 to 2016. However, members will no doubt be aware that the Smith Commission recommended that the Scottish Parliament will have all powers in relation to elections to the Scottish Parliament and local government elections in Scotland. The Scotland Bill will, when enacted, give effect to this recommendation. The timings of when that happens is, though, still very much subject of current debate. However, I think we can be pretty sure it won't happen in time for this Parliament to assume responsibility over elections in Scotland before May of this year. The Scottish and UK governments both agreed that it is important that voters know the length of the parliamentary term that they are voting for before they go to the polls in May. That's why the Deputy First Minister and the Secretary of State for Scotland agreed a Section 30 order under the Scotland Act 1998 to transfer the powers to the Scottish Parliament that has enabled us to bring forward this bill. The Section 30 order was approved by both the Scottish and UK Parliaments. And I hope everyone in this chamber agrees that it is absolutely right that it is this Parliament that legislates to change the date, and that is the purpose of this bill. The Deputy Presiding Officer, turning now to the bill's contents, it is, as I said in my original start of my statement, a very short and straightforward bill. It proposes moving the Scottish Parliament elections, currently scheduled for the 7th of May 2020, to the 6th of May 2021. This would ensure that we avoid coinciding with the Westminster election scheduled for the 7th of May 2020 and would mean a 5-year term for the next Parliament. That would mirror the 1-year extension to this current parliamentary term set by the Fixed Term Parliaments Act of 2011. Members will no doubt be aware that both the Northern Ireland Assembly and the National Assembly for Wales have already moved to elections in 2021 in order to avoid the 2020 clash of date. Indeed, legislation has been passed that permanently changes the frequency of elections to both assemblies to 5-year intervals, and I'll return to that issue in relation to Scotland later in my remarks. Moving the Scottish Parliament elections to May 2021 will mean that it would clash with the local government elections scheduled for the same date. And all the arguments that I've made set out against a Holyrood and Westminster clash equally apply to a Scottish Parliament local government clash, and indeed, of course, it was a Scottish Parliament local government clash in 2007 that brought about the Gould report, which, as I said, was unanimously agreed to. So that 5-year, so changing the local government, so the bill therefore proposes moving the local government elections scheduled for the 6th of May 2021 to the 5th of May 2022. That would mean a five-year term for those councillors elected in May 2017 and would also replicate the one-year extension to the current local government term. Indeed.
John Wilson.
Thank the Minister for giving way. I take on board the points that are being proposed in this bill, but would it not be simpler for the government to come forward with proposals to revert to five-year elections for both local government elections and Scottish Parliament elections, rather than bringing forward piecemeal bills to this chamber to discuss every 4 or 5 years?
Minister.
Okay, that is an interesting point, which I will come to in just 1 second. So I'll come to it when I come to it in my speech, I think. So I now want to move to the discussions that we had at stage one and the stage one report from the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointment Committee. Firstly, I think it's important to place on record my thanks to the convener and the committee members for their scrutiny of the bill and welcome the report's recommendation that the Parliament agree to the general principles of the bill. The committee took a proportionate approach to its scrutiny of what is a very short bill. I also welcome the fact that it recognised the broad consensus in favour of the bill and expressed its support for the approach taken in proposing what I believe to be a pragmatic solution to the issues of a clash of dates. The broad consensus comes from the range of organisations with a direct interest in the proposed date change. We consulted COSLA, the Electoral Commission, the Electoral Management Board, the Electoral Reform Society, SCVO and SOLAS. All were supportive of the proposed changes and none of them raised any issues about the bill's contents. I would ask during my evidence to the committee why we'd opted to move the Parliament election to 2021 in order to avoid the 2020 clash of dates and not instead bring it forward to 2019. That option would have meant a three-year term for the next Parliament. And as I said to the committee, I believe that a three-year term would be particularly short in parliamentary terms. We would really have to question whether the Scottish public would wish to return to the polls so quickly. And furthermore, the proposed five-year term mirrors the length of the current term of Parliament. And so I therefore welcome the fact that the committee states in its report their support for a five-year term rather than 3 years. The committee also posed the question which John Wilson has asked about why we're not taking the opportunity in this bill to permanently resolve future clashes of election dates. And Richard Simpson suggested that it would be sensible to do so in his written submission he made to committee and obviously reflect the comments of John Wilson. But the Section 30 order that enables us to bring this bill forward at all is very specific in giving us the powers to make changes to the 2020 election only. As I said earlier, the permanent powers over elections in Scotland is contained in the Scotland Bill, and so it will be for the next Parliament to consider a permanent solution when the power to do so has been fully devolved. And I was pleased to note that the committee expressed its view that it considers it appropriate that a decision on any permanent changes to the timings of the Scottish Parliament elections should be taken in the next session of Parliament. In his submission to the committee, Richard Simpson went further on this point and suggested that voting for the Scottish Parliament, local government and European elections should all take place on the same date. And I think it should be again pointed out that the Section 30 order that transfers the powers that's allowing us to bring forward this bill specifically prohibits us from setting an election on the same day as the UK Parliament, European Parliament or any national local government elections. And that's in line with the Smith Commission's recommendations and it's how the Scotland Bill deals with the issue. So, again, just reiterating the points I made earlier about the consensus that exists in support of the Gould recommendations to avoid having those different elections on the same date. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I'd like to emphasise that this short bill presents a straightforward and pragmatic solution to the issue of a clash of election dates, and I hope that colleagues agree with that assessment. And I formally move that the Parliament agrees to the general principles of the Scottish Elections Dates Bill.
Many thanks. I now call on Stuart Stevenson to speak on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Mr Stevenson, 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak on behalf of the committee. The Minister, I hope, has not created a hostage to fortune when he said this is a short and straightforward bill. He should be absolutely aware that my committee members and Parliament as a whole will subject this bill to exactly the high standards of scrutiny that he would expect. And, of course, it being a mere 200 words in this bill, it will be rather difficult for any defects to hide in the detail. So we will do the job that we are always required to do. In fact, those 200 words, if one thinks about it, are approximately one quarter of the number of words I would expect to speak in the 6 minutes you have allowed to me, Presiding Officer, which focuses us on precisely how concise this piece of legislation is. The main purpose is to move the election to an appropriate date that doesn't clash with other elections. Now, in considering the bill, the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee had a pretty tight schedule, but given that there was a high degree of consensus in favour of the bill, our being designated as the lead committee on the 25th of November and completing our report just 19 days later on the 14th of December, I think was a proportionate response to what was going on. Our report is, like the bill itself, quite brief, just 24 paragraphs, just over 1,000 words. I'm told by my clerks that Salvador Dali once told a press conference, "I shall be so brief that I have already finished." I'm not quite in that category, but certainly I'm not going to say too much about the bill. We did consider carefully whether to take oral evidence on the bill, but given that the government had widely consulted, including COSLAN, the Electoral Commission in particular, and seen that there was unanimity from these quarters, we concluded that there was no need to reconsult. We restricted our oral evidence to a light grilling for the Minister for Parliamentary Business. We thought that was a proportionate approach. We did explore, as the Minister said, why a five-year term rather than a three-year term was appropriate. And I think we were broadly satisfied with the answers that we heard. 3 years would be short, and for any government of whatever political complexion, that's a relatively limited period in which to develop and get moving any major policy initiatives. And, of course, the other administrations in these islands have already aligned themselves on a five-year cycle. So I think there is a pretty universal consensus that it's sensible. We were also content in relation to the policy memorandum and costs. Clearly, if you move the election back 1 year, it doesn't in and of itself create any new costs, and it does postpone the costs that are associated with an election by a year. So in financial terms, there really is little to say on the matter. We did write to all MSPs to give them the opportunity to input. The Minister has already referred to Dr. Richard Simpson's contribution, which was interesting. And of course, we as politicians can get very tied up in the process of politics. It's not as if reform and change of parliamentary process is something new. The 1832 Great Reform Act perhaps started the reforming motion. It was, as people sometimes forget, the act which actually deprived women of the vote, while purporting to be a great reform of parliamentary procedures. And it was quite a long time before they got it back. 1872, which was in the life of all my grandparents, was the first time we had secret ballots. So in many ways, every few years, we're going to continue to see a reform. This is part of a wide process that probably is not complete with this bill, because we're likely, I imagine, to come back to permanently making changes when they have the power to do so. But that's a matter for another day, Presiding Officer, not one in which we should dwell today. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Elections Date Bill is indeed a short bill. It has very, very specific objectives. I'm expecting a flood of Stage 2 amendments, perhaps not. or even stage three. So I suspect this is something that can make its way through the parliamentary system with the broad consensus that has emerged thus far, ensuring that it does so with proper scrutiny but appropriate rapidity. It's certainly desirable to avoid a clash between the 2020 Scottish Parliament election, the current schedule, and the next UK Parliament election, scheduled for that same year. We support the approach in the bill that the next Scottish Parliament term should last 5 rather than 3 years. We also felt it would be appropriate a decision on permanent changes should be taken in the next session once the powers are given to this Parliament. That will be time for a fuller discussion about the length of future Scottish parliamentary terms at that time. But meantime, the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee are very happy to recommend to Parliament that we agree the general principles of this short but very important bill. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call on Mary Fee. 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In opening for Scottish Labour, can I say at the outset that we support the principles behind the Scottish Election Dates Bill that outlines the dates for the Scottish elections in 2021 and the local government elections in 2022. And as a member of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, I have been involved in the Stage 1 report. And can I take this opportunity to thank the clerks for their help and support in the work that we do on committee. And although this bill is very short and contains 2 small provisions, the committee sought evidence and received 1 piece of written evidence from Dr Richard Simpson, took oral evidence from the Minister for Parliamentary Business and consulted with relevant sectors. The decision for a 5-year parliamentary term reflects the election timings for other parliamentary and devolved administration elections in the United Kingdom. And with the return of a Tory government, that's unlikely to change given the establishment of the Fixed Term Parliament Act. So to avoid clashing with the scheduled UK general election in 2020, the Scottish Government has opted for a 5-year term and rejected the idea of a 3-year term. And both options of a 3 and a 5-year term have their merits. And as I said earlier, Scottish Labour fully supports the Scottish Government proposal for the next Scottish Parliament election to be held in 2021. And this also impacts on the local government elections that were due to take place, and we welcome the move to postpone these elections for 1 year. And following the confusion that unfolded in 2007, when the Scottish elections and the local government elections were held on the same day, we are clearly keen to avoid any repeat. However, I think we need to bear in mind that situations can change, and who knows, at a future time, we may consider revisiting the possibility of holding Council and Scottish Parliament elections on the same day. And should that situation arise, we must work as a unified chamber. Yes, certainly.
John Wilson.
Would the member recognise in the last session of Parliament that the Gould report recommended a complete separation from local government and Scottish Parliament elections? In the initial stages, we had a 2-year gap. It was programmed for a 2-year gap that the local government elections would be held out with the Scottish parliamentary timetable, so there would be a clear division between Scottish Parliament elections and local government elections.
Yes, I mean, I absolutely acknowledge what the member is saying. I am merely raising that in a future time, who knows, the situation may arise where we decide to revisit that. And I am merely saying that it's something that we should perhaps be open to at a future time. Dr Richard Simpson called for the Scottish elections to be held on the same day as the European elections, as we have heard previously. And whilst there is some merit in that suggestion, the committee heard that this is not possible as a result of a clause in the Scotland Bill following the Smith Commission recommendations. And the idea of holding more than one election on the same day does, to a degree, have the opportunity to increase turnout in one that usually receives lower participation. And in that case, I can understand Dr Richard Simpson's thinking, as the European elections in 2014 saw only 33.5% of the Scottish electorate take part, despite the increased attention on these elections resulting from the referendum campaign, which then attracted a record 85% turnout. And the general election last year saw a turnout of 71%. And in a few months, we could perhaps expect a turnout of anything from 65% upwards. And as I said earlier, there are merits for both options of a 3- and a 5-year term. And the advantages of a 5-year term include the most obvious one of avoiding a clash with the UK general election in 2020. A 5-year term also provides stability for government and for long-term strategic planning and allows for parties to fully develop policy ideas. And one academic I spoke with warned that the present system of elections almost every year means that parties are constantly either preparing or running election campaigns, leaving them with little time to spend on policy development or the real work of government, or indeed the work of opposition. Some disadvantages of a 5-year term include issues around accountability, fewer opportunities for the electorate to engage in holding the government to account, and if that same party were in for 2 consecutive terms, then that would result in 10 years instead of 8, as is the norm around most of the world. I'm presiding officer, with the bill containing 2 small provisions and no issues surrounding the timing of the next Scottish election following those in May, can I repeat that Scottish Labour fully supports the principles behind the bill and will support the bill throughout its parliamentary process? Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Anna Mulgoldy, 4 minutes or thereby, please, Ms Goldie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I also offer my thanks to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee for its work in bringing forward the Stage 1 report. And Mr Stevenson offered a quotation in brevity, and I use the adage from Hamlet, therefore, since brevity is the soul of wit and tediousness the limbs and outward flourishes, I will be brief. The bill before us today contains a short and sensible pair of proposals, and it will be receiving the support of this side of the chamber at decision time. Now, before approaching the substance of the bill, I think it's worth reflecting that the powers we are exercising are yet another example of further devolution in practice. The powers have been devolved initially by order in council, and they will be made permanent by the Scotland Bill currently before the UK Parliament. Now, the devolution of electoral administration for this Parliament is yet another example of my party's commitment to the Smith Commission process, reflected in the Smith Agreement, and further fulfilment of the pledge to create a United Kingdom where more decisions are made closer to the individuals and communities which they affect. With reference to the bill itself, we have in this Parliament developed a cross-party agreement that elections to this Parliament should not fall on the same day as general elections to the House of Commons or potentially other significant elections. And following the Gould report in 2007, this has almost worked its way into something of a constitutional convention, and I think it is a sound one. I know there have been 1 or 2 dissenting voices. Mr Stevenson himself, I believe, expressed some reservations in committee, and Dr Richard Simpson's submission has already been referred to. But the option to which I am referring was expressly rejected by the Smith Commission, and as a member of that commission, I support the findings of its reports, which were approved by representatives of all parties in this Parliament. And the agreement confirms that while control over Scottish Parliament elections should be almost entirely devolved, UK legislation should prohibit the holding of a Scottish Parliament election on the same day as a UK general election, local government elections, or elections to the European Parliament. And that is all incorporated into Clause 5 of the Scotland Bill. But I do share a lot of sympathy with the wish to see a more established convention regulating the length of parliamentary sessions for this Parliament. And I thought Mary Fee made some interesting and thoughtful observations. The Fixed-Term Parliaments Act is now a reasonably well-established part of the British Constitution in relation to Westminster, and as such, there'll have to be a real debate on the timescale for Scottish Parliament elections. The powers for elections beyond 2021 are, as the Minister indicated, unlikely to be devolved before this session ends, and as the Minister made clear, that makes the future position a question for the next Parliament, a Parliament where myself and many others will no longer be members. And what I'm offering are purely personal reflections. My party will, of course, have to confirm its position during the next session. The Minister has said he agrees with the parliamentary term being set at 5 years, and this reflects the length of this session, and the 2021 election date has been agreed by our colleagues in the devolved assemblies in Wales and Northern Ireland. So there's no doubt there's some advantage in consistency here. But I think a five-year term has been more a default position adopted out of necessity than a positive conclusion that 5 years is necessarily the best term for a devolved parliament. And I would just remind the chamber, it's worth remembering that the four-year model has a long history. It dates back to the recommendations of the 1973 Cobrandon report of the Royal Commission and the Constitution. It's a thread running through the prehistory of this Parliament from the 1978 Scotland Act through the conclusions of the Scottish Constitutional Convention to the Westminster debates in the late 1990s, which led to this Parliament being created. And while reserving my judgment on the merits, it would still be possible, from my understanding, to maintain a four-year electoral cycle by moving Holyrood elections to a different time of the year. And again, I don't seek to state whether this would be a political clash in those sessions where devolved UK elections would fall less than a year apart. I'm merely observing that I think the option is there. And I would further observe that elections falling in May are a relatively recent innovation. There are plenty of examples in recent decades of elections falling in October, November, or even December. I simply want to demonstrate, Deputy Presiding Officer, there is scope for debate. And that's where I disagree with Mr. Wilson's view, because I think that debate's important. I think it should take place. An enduring settlement on parliamentary terms is essential to fulfil the very reasonable decision that this Parliament should have consistent fixed terms. And all I would do, it will not fall to me to play a role in this. This will be the responsibility of the next Parliament, but I would urge members to keep an open mind about that. But in the meantime, I do support this bill.
Thank you much. And we now move to open debate, and I call on Stuart McMillan to be followed by Anne McTaggart. 4 minutes, so thereby, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do welcome the chance to take part in this short debate, and I want to express my thanks to the committee for such a succinct report. Members highlight how often that we should be producing shorter reports when we do committee work, but we don't always achieve this. But certainly, I think in this particular case that actually has happened. And I'm sure if it was a long report, bearing in mind the bill's only got four sections, then I'm sure questions would have been asked of the convener and the committee members. But both the bill and the report highlight, in clear terms, the limited scope of the bill and the reason for the proposed change. The report also highlights a lack of a campaign against the bill, which is helpful in this case. I thought the convener's questioning during the oral evidence session of a three-year term certainly was worth pursuing to seek clarity on the matter, but I do agree with the report that suggested that the five-year term is a more consistent approach to the parliamentary term in the next session. Certainly, as we know, Presiding Officer, I mean, this particular session is a five-year term as well. And I think that's, certainly for the next session, I think it's a common-sense approach that's going to be taken. I believe that the elections clashing with each other dilutes one of those particular elections. Therefore, I do disagree with the suggestion put forward by Dr. Richard Simpson to hold the Scottish local authority and European elections on the same day. Similarly, Dr. Simpson's suggestion to hold the election on a weekend day would be fraught with difficulties. The evidence received to the former Referendum Scotland Bill Committee, we took evidence on this particular issue regarding the referendum. And to actually hold an election or the referendum on a weekend day would actually have other implications, particularly those from religious backgrounds. And that certainly came across when we went through the evidence at the time. But this bill will certainly provide clarity for the forthcoming session and certainly will also aid the electoral cycle now that Westminster has finally moved into the 21st century and introduced a fixed term parliament. Elections at the whim of whoever's in charge at the time has never made any sense to me, and ultimately parliamentarians are elected to serve the population, not to pick and choose election dates to suit party leaders. The committee convener has laid out, also in clear terms, the limitations placed upon this parliament regarding organising Scottish parliamentary elections, and I believe that this parliament obtaining the power to determine the length of the upcoming session is welcome. With powers to determine future Scottish parliamentary elections in the current Scotland Bill, then this particular process need not be repeated. However, the Scotland Bill does need to secure the support of this chamber, and as we know, Presiding Officer, discussions regarding the financial framework continue in an attempt to find a suitable outcome. I touched upon the clash of elections a few moments ago, and I want to progress that point a little bit further. In 1999, 2003 and 2007, Scotland elected parliamentarians and councillors on the same day. Prior to 1999, this was considered to be a more cost-effective and efficient way of electing representatives. but it soon became apparent that council elections and issues surrounding local authorities were not being fully aired during campaigning. And the separation of elections, therefore, was, in my opinion, was a positive step, and it certainly has allowed local authority issues to be fully discussed, and we saw that during the 2012 council elections. By extending the next local authority elections by 1 year, guarantees that local authority matters can quite rightly take centre stage in their particular election in 2022. Presiding officer, this bill appears to have universal support from across the chamber, and that's something to be welcomed. It's a common sense approach to deal with the upcoming election and subsequent council election. But I do look forward to the day, however, when this Parliament doesn't need to have a sticking plaster approach via the Section 30 process to introduce a short-term fix. But until such times, I do welcome the approach that has been taken thus far. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Anne McTaggart, after which we'll move to the closing speeches.
Thank you.
4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am delighted to contribute to this debate, as I believe that this is an important issue to everyone in this chamber. The Scottish Election Dates Bill will allow changing the date of the Scottish Parliament election on the 7th of May 2020 to the 6th of May 2021, so that it does not clash with the UK general election, meaning a five-year term for the Scottish Parliament again, as it's currently the case between 2011 and 2016. However, this also means that the bill has to allow changing the date of the Scottish local government elections due on the 6th of May 2021 to the 5th of May 2022, so they do not clash with the new date of the Scottish Parliament election. The local government elections will then revert to every 4 years after 2022. This is not a first occurrence where we need to change the dates of the election in order to avoid clashes with other elections since the Scottish Parliament was created. However, with the new powers coming to the Scottish Parliament next year, Holyrood will be able to set a date which avoids holding the poll on the same day as the UK Parliament, European Parliament or local government elections. The Scottish Parliament will also have the power to set permanent term lengths. The move is consistent with the Smith Commission's recommendation that power over Scottish elections should be devolved to the Scottish Parliament. Since May 2014, in Scotland, we have had a referendum, the European Parliament election, a general election, and we are going into Scottish Parliament elections in May, and then local election next year. We get a year off, big sigh, in 2018, and we have the European Parliament election again in 2019, the general election in 2020, and so on. Although holding two elections on the same day might eliminate any potential confusion to the electorate, the practice of holding other electoral competitions, such as the local elections and the referendums at the same time, are as the European elections should be considered in the next term of the Scottish Parliament. Many countries in Europe, such as England, Ireland, Sweden, already often hold joint elections. This is due to different factors such as the low voter participation and often occurrence of elections. I share the view of Dr. Richard Simpson, MSP, who in his written submission to the committee supports this practice, stating that these measures would allow for and encourage more democracy and reduce the overall costs. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, although this is an extremely short bill with clear objectives, it is a vital one for the people of Scotland, as it will eliminate any potential confusion if elections are to clash. However, I believe that the Scottish election dates should be reassessed again when the new powers come to Holyrood for the greater efficiency. Thank you.
Thanks so much. And we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Animal Goldie. 4 minutes, please, Ms Goldie.
Deputy Presiding Officer, it is clear that the bill will gain broad support today, and I think it's also important that it has the full approval of COSLA. The Minister has suggested to committee that it does. does, and I think that buy-in is extremely important, because local authorities will have to deal with electoral administration. They will also have their own election dates changed, and we have to take full account of their views in our deliberations, not to mention the further ramifications for electoral registration officers, returning officers, and the general electoral administrative process. In my opening speech, I touched on some of our long-term options, and I'm pleased that other members have clearly given thought to this important question. The government has indicated that it is its intention to put the choice for future parliaments out to public consultation, and I welcome that commitment. And I hope it is truly a wide-ranging consultation and that the evidence received is useful in informing the next parliament on its approach. We should avoid thinking of any particular choice as the default position. As I highlighted in my earlier speech, each has its advantages and disadvantages, and these points have already been made by contributions from the Chamber. I mean, for example, with the choice at this forthcoming election of a three-year parliament, I for one think that's too short. And as a stopgap, certainly this bill will receive the Chamber's approval, but I think we must be clear that that should not be perceived as tying in any member or any party to a five-year model in perpetuity. Now, to many, this topic may seem a dry one. Well, it's very important that we have real consideration and discussion about the fundamentals of how this Parliament operates, because this is a choice of constitutional importance. The Chartists famously fought for elections every year. One aspiration I'm sure we are all somewhat pleased never became a reality. The Triennial Act in 1694 limited the length of Parliaments in England to 3 years, while in 1716 the Septennial Act set a limit of 7 years. And the modern five-year limit came in 1911, although that was breached by emergency legislation during the wars. Now, this Parliament is soon to be faced with a choice of equal importance about the period for elections and how long the sessions should last. And while this bill is a forerunner of that debate, I think it's very important we should make sure this bill does not usurp that debate. And let us also make sure that we lay the groundwork for giving that debate and that choice the very serious consideration which it merits.
Many thanks. I now call on James Kelly. 5 minutes, please, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party to have the opportunity to close this afternoon's debate on stage one of the Scottish Elections Bill. As my colleague Mary Fee said in opening, Scottish Labour will be supporting the bill at decision time tonight, as will all the parties in the Parliament. And I think that is that's very important, because we are changing the kind of previously defined date of the next Scottish or the Scottish parliamentary election after this coming one would have been. And I think it's important all political parties agree to that, because if there wasn't consensus on it, it could have caused real difficulties and friction in terms of getting this piece of legislation through. Clearly, this has been driven by practicalities. Obviously, it's a repeat of the decision which we saw ahead of the 2011 election, and has been driven by the introduction of the Fixed Term Parliaments Act at a UK level and five-year terms there. I think it's absolutely correct that the government have brought forward this proposal, and you know, it's the logical thing to do. You cannot run UK and Scottish Parliament elections on the same day, apart from the fact that those elections are considering different issues in terms of reserved and devolved issues. The elections have a completely different dynamic to them, so it's important that those are separated out. There's been some discussion about possible consideration of a three-year term, but you know, I think I conclude on balance that it's right that that's too short, and therefore the practicalities are correct in terms of moving to a five-year term. Sure.
Jameson?
Before making my intervention, I do so in a personal capacity, not as convener of the committee. Perhaps the member and perhaps some others might remember that in 1979 we had a referendum at the beginning of March, a general election at the beginning of May, and the European elections at the beginning of June. So while recognising the merit of the proposal that our colleague on my right said, that we could have two in 1 year as long as they're far enough apart, that it's not an encouraging precedent for anything other than having them at least a year apart.
I mean, I take that point, and I think this is actually quite an interesting discussion. Of course, going back to 1974, there was two general elections in the 1 year, you know, so we have been here before. I think Annabel Goldie made a really interesting contribution, you know, and I think going forward to the next Parliament, the crux of the issue is that we're going to have to conclude, do we want 4 or 5 year terms? Certainly in my experience, I have been more used to, you know, 4 year terms in local government and also in this Scottish Parliament. The advantage of that is that, in a sense, it's more democratic because the political administrations... just let me make this point. The political administrations are up for election on a more regular cycle. And I think there's some merit in that, and there's some merit in some of the points that Annabel Goldie made. I'll give way to John Wilson.
Is Mr. Kelly, by inference, saying that European Parliament elections and the Westminster elections are less democratic because they are five-year terms?
I'm certainly not saying that. What I'm saying in this contribution is and that there's a case for four-year terms and there's a case for five-year terms. What I was going on to say was that in terms of the five-year terms, obviously you have a longer term, you have more stability. That's better for planning, particularly budget and financial and policy planning. So there are advantages in a five-year term, and I recognise that. I wouldn't say I'm stuck to any particular solution at this time, but I do say that Annabel Goldie made some really kind of pertinent points. And in summing up, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think what is going to be essential in the next Parliament is that we come up with a solution to the electoral cycle for both the Scottish Parliament and local council elections. I think it's right that the government take widespread evidence on it, and I will study that evidence closely to see which cycle is best. I don't think we should be... I think we've been driven in recent times because of the change at a UK level towards five-year terms, and it's not... of course, it's absolutely practical what we're doing, but... it's maybe not necessarily, a five-year term is maybe not necessarily the right thing. So I think we need proper consideration of those issues in order to look at the electoral cycles for all administrations. Thank you.
Hey, thanks. I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick to wind up the debate. 7 minutes, Minister, thereby, please.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. So I'm going to begin my closing remarks by thanking all members for their contributions. This is an incredibly short bill, but it's interesting that how quickly, you know, there's clear consensus about what we should do now, but clearly there's a debate to be had about what we do going forward. And, you know, but it is important that in terms of what this bill is doing, then across the chamber, in terms of changing the date of the Scottish Parliament election and changing the date of the local council election, there is unanimity across this chamber. But you know, there has been some discussion today, and there was discussion at the committee. I think all members touched on the need for, and John Wilson raised in his intervention, the need for a permanent solution to the clash of Holyrood and Westminster election dates. So assuming this bill is passed, then the 2020 clash of elections will of course be avoided. However, as things currently stand, the frequency of both parliament elections would mean that another clash would occur in 2025, and again every 20 years. So there is a need for us to look at what that permanent solution is. Otherwise, we have the, as Stuart McMillan said, the sticking plaster approach every time there's a clash. And you know, when the powers come to this parliament, it will be absolutely appropriate for us to look at all the issues, and I've listened very carefully to all the remarks that have been made today. I think at the committee, I am on record have suggesting that I think there's a strong argument for a five-year cycle, but arguments for other cycles have been made today, and I particularly listened to the comments made by Annabel Goldie, who's bringing forward a different solution, which would mean every 20 or so years we would have two elections in the same year, but at different at different times of the year, so there wouldn't be the direct clash. So that's an interesting choice. And these are all things which I think it is very important that are decided by the next Parliament. Very important that these are very carefully considered. And you know, as was said, I think Ms Goldie said that the government would consult very carefully on these issues and make sure that we take the widest possible view about the implications. Because although we obviously feel the issue of elections is very pertinent to us as politicians, it's obviously also very important to the electorate and to other organisations. So the impact on organisations who want to influence policy making, if there was a Westminster and Scottish Parliament election on in the same year, that's a significant drain on their resources, and they want to be able to take part in that. So it is important that when this Parliament comes to discuss a permanent solution to the polling date clashes, that there is the widest possible consultation possible. And I think that's correct. And it's great that today we managed to kick that off by saying that it's not just a 4-year or 5-year, but there's potential for actually shifting the day of election. Although there's a fair degree of history for... Obviously, every Scottish election has been in May, so it would be a significant change for a Scottish Parliament election to be held at another time. But let's get back to the consensus and back to this bill. This bill is about changing, fixing the solution for the 2020 clash and dealing with a subsequent clash for the local government elections in 2021. And I think that this bill offers that solution. I welcome the tenor of today's debate which obviously suggests that members across the chamber agree that the government has got this right. I don't anticipate the government will bring forward any amendments to the bill at stage two, but I take on board the convener's point that there's a parliamentary process going forward, and it's we absolutely expect the committee to give this bill the same regard as all other bills. And as he says, it's a relatively short bill, but I think it's a very significant bill and very important. Again, I thank members for their contribution to today's debate and invite members to support me in agreeing the principles of the Scottish Elections Dates Bill.
Many thanks. And that concludes the debate on stage one of the Scottish Elections Dates Bill. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15220. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to speak to and move motion. Minister, you have 13 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In opening this debate, I would highlight that the Lobbying Scotland Bill is an unusual bill. Yet it's a bill being brought forward by the government, and yet it is very much parliamentary in nature. For that reason, I have been keen from the outset to work closely with the Parliament in order to ensure that its views are reflected in the proposed legislation. I think we're all agreed that lobbying is a legitimate activity. We also recognise the valuable contribution that lobbying plays to informing policymaking in Scotland. But it's right that we seek to improve transparency in lobbying activity in order to retain the public's trust, particularly in light of continuing constitutional change. And we can look at the results of a recent poll commissioned by the Scottish Alliance for Lobbying Transparency, which indicated that 3/4 of the public respondents are in favour of the creation of a register. Our shared objectives, therefore, is to ensure that the Parliament puts in place a robust, workable and, above all, proportionate lobbying registration scheme in Scotland. We must do so while listening to the views of a range of stakeholders. The government's lobbying bill is founded firmly on the basis of a shared endeavour. When the government announced its intentions to legislate in this area, a rationale for doing so was made clear. The question of whether Parliament should establish a lobbying register was and remains a significant move and one which requires careful consideration. The government was therefore persuaded that we should put our full weight and resources behind the proposal, but recognise from the outset the need to reflect Parliament's wishes. I remain firmly of the view that the end product must be something that members across the chamber will be able to stand behind. Today's debate allows that process to continue. Against that backdrop, we welcomed the late Helen Eady's suggestion that the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee should contribute to determining what measures should be appropriate to the Scottish context by holding a committee inquiry. I'm very grateful to the Parliament and the committee for its close involvement in the progression of this bill, the detail of which I will outline later. For the Government's part, throughout the development of the lobbying bill, ministers have been guided by three underpinning principles. Firstly, there cannot be any erosion of the Parliament's principles of openness, ease of access and accountability. Civic engagement is something that Parliament does well and something that people truly welcome. Many have commented on the Parliament's openness and hold that accessibility in high regard. The valuable relationship this Parliament has fashioned with all Scottish stakeholders has not only contributed to its many successes, but also been integral to its swift development into a significant and trusted feature within Scottish society. The second guiding principle is that the register of lobbyists must complement and not duplicate existing transparency measures. There are many existing frameworks established within this Parliament and indeed government to deliver probity around lobbying. A lobbying register must be developed to fit within that landscape as opposed to being viewed as a catch-all singular solution. And the third principle is that the new arrangements need to be proportionate, simple in their operation and command broad support both within and out with Parliament. Proportionality and simplicity are both key considerations. We need to minimise the burden on those who will need to register, and there needs to be clear what is expected of them to comply with the new scheme. And in terms of Parliament as operators of the registration scheme, the parliamentary authorities also need arrangements that are as clear as possible for the public and avoid capturing activity that would reasonably be viewed as trivial or immaterial to its purpose. These three underpinning principles have been generally welcomed by stakeholders and are at the heart of the bill that I have presented to Parliament. They will continue to guide my thinking as the bill proceeds through its parliamentary stages and in respect of the representations for change which are put to me. Our policy objective is to ensure that we maintain the public's trust in this institution by bringing added transparency. Our aim is to shed light on lobbying activity which is designed to influence actions of ministers and members for a particular purpose. The bill is not intended to interfere with day-to-day relationships that each of us has with our constituents. In that regard, Patricia Ferguson made a very important point during my evidence session to the committee on the 19th of November, when she highlighted the importance of being clear that the register should be designed to capture lobbying and not simply engagement. And I agree fully with the point that she made, and we need to ensure that we don't unduly erode legitimate engagement between the public and their elected representatives. I therefore continue to look carefully at the bill in the area of discussions between elected members have with their constituents, and will consider any necessary changes to protect those relationships in due course. I mentioned the key role of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee has played in helping to develop the policy contained in the bill. The Government welcomed the committee's announcement in September 2013 of an inquiry into lobbying, as I said earlier. That inquiry took evidence from a wide range of stakeholders, including campaign groups, representatives of the consultant lobbying industry, the voluntary and business sectors, and academics. The inquiry concluded in February of 2015 with the publication of the committee's report. The committee reaffirmed what has become the universal conclusion that lobbying is a legitimate and valuable activity. It invited the government to adopt the recommendations set out in the report on the basis of its proposed legislation to establish a lobbying register. And it confirmed the committee's view that a register based on its recommendation would constitute a substantial new body of information which would make a notable contribution to increased transparency. And it invited the government to work closely with the Scottish Parliament's corporate body on any proposals that would impact on parliamentary resources. Deputy Presiding Officer, the committee report in February 2015 was pivotal in helping to shape the bill that is now in front of Parliament. Indeed, of the 17 recommendations in the committee's February 2015 report, 12 fell within the scope of the bill, and all of these have been reflected in whole or in part. Government also consulted on its proposals for legislation, as informed by the committee's conclusions, and the feedback received has also influenced the drafting of the legislation. We can now turn to the committee's Stage 1 report. Clearly, we welcome the committee's support for the bill's general principles. And given that the proposals in the bill will impact on every single member, it is very important indeed that we take the views of the Chamber as a whole prior to finalising and publishing the government's formal responses. And that's consistent with the inclusive approach that's been typified in the ongoing development of this bill. I do, however, wish to offer colleagues some initial thoughts on the content of the report. The committee's agreement to the bill's core principle of focusing on lobbying involving payment is welcome. That underpins the nature of lobbying activity that we understand to be relevant for capture, and indeed helps to distinguish such activity from that of engagement between a constituent and their elected representatives. Members will note that unpaid lobbying does not require registration, although the bill allows for voluntary registration of unpaid lobbying activity. I note the committee's thinking has, however, moved in respect of two key areas on the model that it endorsed in February 2015. Firstly, the committee has asked the government to review whether the scope of the bill should be widened to include communications of any kind. The government is willing to keep an open mind on this issue and listen to whatever evidence is made available to support such a position. However, it will not surprise members to hear that the government is extremely cautious as to the merits of that approach. Of course.
Neil Findlay.
Let me exemplify the point. If the minister has a problem with, say, a product he has bought or a bill that he gets, and he has to contact, say, a company based in India or America, does he book a flight and turn up at the door because he has to speak to the person in face-to-face in order to resolve that problem? Or does he lift a phone and deal with it there and then?
Minister?
As I said, the government is keeping an open mind to the point. I think our starting point and the point in terms of attempting to get a proportionate response is what is the most significant form of lobbying. And we've written the bill on the basis that the most... Let me finish the point. The most significant lobbying is face-to-face lobbying. However, I'm not saying that other forms of interaction are not also lobbying.
To ask a question, is most of our time taken up by meeting people face-to-face, or is most of our time dealt with taken up by dealing with communications of another type?
Gilbert Spencer.
Well, I think in terms of actual time, I suppose we'd all have to go and have a look at our diaries in terms of how much time you would spend specifically meeting with people. I'm clear that I think that it is the most significant form of lobbying is face-to-face, but I'm not saying for a second that other forms of communication are not significant as well, and so that is why we are continue to have an open view on this. In the consultation, there are some respondents to our consultation made calls for written communication to be a trigger for registration, and they highlighted the points that Mr. Findlay makes there, that as a matter of fact, some communications could constitute lobbying. And as I said, the government is absolutely clear and we acknowledge that point. But in response, we have to highlight that we are trying to introduce a proportionate approach to the lobbying registration. A starting point is to question whether or not it is proportionate to extend the registration to written correspondence directed to MSPs and ministers. And members, I would hope across the chamber, would appreciate the volume of such correspondence, and not just received by members, but also received by ministers. As an example, is the number of representations received in advance of today's debate from stakeholders. And I'm sure other members also received that I'm sure other members also received pretty heavy volumes of written evidence in advance of today's debate. And I'm sure people appreciated that information helped them prepare for today's deliberations from across the perspective.
I thank the Minister for taking another intervention, and it's a very brief point I wanted to raise with the Minister. Perhaps the Minister could clarify for the Chamber, in what forum did he receive communication about this lobbying bill? What was the bulk of the communication that he got received in?
Minister, and I will give you extra time, Minister.
Okay. So, in terms of volume, like everyone else, I've probably received more volume in emails, absolutely, and it's significant. However, in terms of time that I've spent engaging on this issue this week, I've spent more time engaging. I've spent more time. I think I've read every single email in terms of this bill that has come in myself. However, if I can continue, I've had meetings with stakeholders on all sides of this debate, and I think those were very significant, and I appreciate those meetings that I had with SALT and with others this week. So, yeah.
Mr. Wilson.
Minister, would you make a distinction between lobbying and organised lobbying? The majority of emails I've had this week in relation to this issue and other issues that I've been bombarded with in the last couple of days, from individuals who have taken up that issue on behalf of or the concerns that they may have, because I think there is a distinction between organised lobbying from paid lobbyists and individuals who feel so strongly about an issue that they feel they want to write to their elected members.
To make some progress, but absolutely, and the bill as it's drafted absolutely makes that distinction. I think that's very important. So the government's consultation and government's consultation demonstrated strong support for registration of oral face-to-face communication, seeing this as striking an appropriate balance given the context of no evidence of wrongdoing in the eyes of some and no case for registration at all in the eyes of others. While it would be possible in principle to extend registration to all forms of communication, the question that I think we have to answer is whether that would be a proportionate response and to be sure that it would not deter engagement with the Parliament. Any negative effects of this sort would be precisely what we are thinking we have to avoid. So the government believes that there is a risk that it would have such an effect and to the detriment of both organisations engaging with the Parliament and elected representatives. That is something that will have to be considered very carefully, and I would be interested in hearing members' views on that. As I said, our ears are not closed to the arguments. The other areas the committee referred to was in terms of special advisers and civil servants. Stage one records my response to the proposal to extension, and I think my point was that MSPs and ministers are decision makers and legislators, and advisers are just that. But again, it would of course be perfectly possible to extend the bill in that way, but again, we need to consider the evidence and any potential implications for such an extension. So again, our mind is not closed to the point, but equally we need to test any extension against the principle of proportionality. And again, I'd invite colleagues' views on whether senior civil servants and senior advisers to ministers and MSPs should be covered by the bill. The committee's report also included some recommendations around practical aspects of the registration framework, collective bargaining, the appropriateness of the current exception for meetings initiated by elected members, and I will deal with those in due course in our response. But for now, Presiding Officer, and thank you for your indulgence. I think there's obviously some important points that we had to make. I think the bill, as introduced, seeks to balance interests of a wide range of stakeholders and to avoid any unwelcome imbalances that could work against the Parliament's interests. I want to hold up the fact that the bill as it stands has considerable flexibility available to Parliament in the light of experience to alter the operational aspects of the registration scheme. I hope members will agree that this legislation represents a firm foundation for the establishment of an initial scheme to underpin a register of lobbying activity. I look forward to hearing the views expressed during the debate, and I move that the Parliament agrees to the general principles of the Lobbying Scotland Bill.
Thank you very much. I now call on Stuart Stevenson to speak on behalf of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Mr Stevenson, you have 9 minutes, so thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The term lobbying can, for some people at least, conjure up images of dubious characters loitering in the corridors of power, attempting to gain unfair advantage over the ordinary citizen. And indeed, the origins of the term are from the Willard Hotel in Washington, where Ulysses S. Grant, President of the United States, who used to retire for his brandy and cigars in the evening, would be accosted in the lobby of the hotel by people seeking to influence public policy. So it was face-to-face in the original times. No telephones in 1820, it would be fair to say. The committee has, however, had a long-term view that modern lobbying is a positive and necessary part of any democracy that equips decision-makers with valuable information and, more importantly, allows individuals, firms, organisations to engage with and influence policymakers, as they've every right to do. What this bill aims to do is to bring a perfectly legitimate activity out into the open. If everyone can see who's contributed to the decision-making process, then those decisions should have greater legitimacy and be more representative, and it ought to be made easier to hold account decision-makers. Outcomes which I think are broadly supported across the Parliament. But equally, we're aware of the danger of creating barriers or the appearance of barriers for smaller organisations and individuals whom we wish to see engaging with Parliament. And vitally, we must leave MSPs and our constituents able to interact with each other on matters of local interest. Now, the committee's work does go back in this area some time, as the Minister outlined. Following Neil Findlay, MSP's proposal for a Member's Bill in 2013, the committee held the inquiry looking into the question of whether there needed to be more information available to the public about who lobbies the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. A report was produced in February 2013 and set out a series of proposals which, to a very large extent, have informed the Government's bill that's before us today. Nevertheless, in the light of evidence we had during our Stage 1 inquiry, we think there are issues to consider further. The bill, as currently drafted, will only require lobbyists to register if they have face-to-face meetings with MSPs and ministers. I will.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Warren Buffet once said that contribution, particularly of those in public service, requires integrity, intellect and energy, and without the first one, the other two are useless. I think you would agree that we should seek to retain all of these, and the evidence to date, certainly my evidence to date, is that these characteristics are endemic in this Parliament. I'm therefore concerned, even sure, that the consequence of the bill may, in the long run, be the very opposite of that intended, and that these characteristics may well be damaged. Would the member accept that should the bill go ahead, should it go ahead, that the committee will ensure there will be no exceptions proposed for different types of lobbyists?
Stevenson?
Well, the committee's view is that in seeking to differentiate between lobbyists who are paid, who lobby as part of their paid activity, and those individuals and organisations that are voluntary and where there is no financial or other similar reward to people, we think that distinction is a good one. The member referred to integrity, intellect and energy. I suspect, and I cannot speak for the committee because we did not discuss it in quite those terms, but I suspect that the committee would see a register of lobbyists and showing light into what goes on in lobbying as an excellent example for us all to demonstrate those three attributes of integrity, intellect and energy. Now, Presiding Officer, we understand that the definition to which I've just been referring is designed to capture most meaningful interactions, and a line was drawn in an effort to produce a light-touch regime. Nevertheless, thinking about this since our original report, we felt this approach may be too narrow and create the impression of there being options open to organisations wishing to avoid scrutiny. We therefore have recommended that consideration be given to widening the definition of registrable lobbying to include all forms of communication. We've not looked directly at the potential effects of this and hence asked the government to do that. In practice, my personal experience, and I stress it is my personal experience, doesn't suggest that an extension of the definition the way we suggest would significantly increase the number of registrants. My personal reflection is that we must test to see whether it would inhibit communication between MSPs and constituents. That's one of the essential tests. We mustn't overburden organisations, most particularly small organisations, pursuing legitimate campaigns and create an administrative headache for them or for Parliament. The former are the more important. During the Bill's progress, we will not, of course, be deciding what the contents of the proposed register would be. That is something which Parliament will come to after the passage of the Bill. However, at this stage, it's worth saying that the committee are not suggesting that the details of every phone call, email should appear in the register, merely that the fact there have been such communications and what their purpose has been. This would otherwise, if we had all that detail, generate a great deal of repetitive information, possibly render the register less useful and less accessible to citizens by burying the relevant information. I will.
Finlay.
Having read the committee report, I understand the committee rejected thresholds, which I personally think is an error, because that would have meant that incidental lobbying and small-scale lobbying would not be captured. And I wonder if he maybe could elaborate on why the committee rejected those thresholds.
I think there is an element of judgment in this, presiding officer. There isn't an absolute certainty. But the test of only including people who receive reward for their lobbying is a very simple and objective one. The test of having a threshold, which the committee discussed at some length, is a more difficult one to come up with a watertight definition of. Now, that is something which, as the bill goes forward, I'm sure we can return to at stage two and stage three and debate further. But I think I'm correct in reporting the committee's considerations in those terms, and that's why we came to the conclusion that we did. But it is a judgment call. It is not an absolute issue. The bottom line is we ask the government, as the bill moves forward, to find a way to demonstrate that any alteration of the definition of lobbying leaves acceptably modest administrative burdens for those lobbying, while also delivering a useful and accessible register. I take it I have a little flexibility in time, presiding officer.
9 minutes, Mr Stevenson, but there's little flexibility.
Right, thank you, presiding officer, that's helpful. During our inquiry, we looked at the distinction the bill made between paid and unpaid, and we basically endorsed the government's approach. It is right that any citizen can lend their voice to a cause or support an organisation in an unpaid capacity without having to register. And we also agreed that the distinction that's been made elsewhere between professional lobbyists, whatever they are, and in-house lobbyists, is not one that we would wish to see echoed here. Under the bill as currently drafted, you would not, for example, be required to register following a meeting with a minister or MSP, provided they initiated the meeting. Now, we understand and accept the rationale behind the exception, which was designed to ensure there are no restraints on MSPs and ministers entering into discourse with stakeholders, experts and representative groups who may have a particular set of skills or knowledge that allows them to make a valuable contribution to policy and otherwise challenge what is proposed. We share the view that MSPs and ministers should be able to have this kind of interaction with specialists without having to go and register. But in practice, we have some concerns. If matters are discussed during a chance meeting or at a dinner or an event, who initiated the meeting and how can that be demonstrated? We think this could be difficult, and we therefore invite the government to look at this approach and see if there are ways that can offer greater clarity and certainty. When it comes to the subjects of lobbying, we were persuaded by those who gave evidence that the Bill's restrictions to MSPs and ministers was too narrow. While we accept the argument that ministers are ultimately responsible for decisions, other office holders are clearly involved in their inception. Importantly, lobbying organisations who spoke to us considered that such interactions to be of equal value to meetings with ministers. Accordingly, we've asked the government to consider bringing forward amendments to broaden the definition to include communications made to other public officials, such as civil servants, special advisers and senior staff. Finally, we did hear arguments suggesting expenditure should be provided. I come back to the point that this is a matter that Parliament can consider further when we look at the orders we would bring forward after the passage of the bill. Parliament is founded on the principles of openness, accessibility, participation. Get this right, the bill promotes these values, allows everybody to participate in equal footing. We look forward to continuing to work with the government in any changes it brings forward, and I am happy to say that the committee endorses the view that Parliament should adopt the general principles of the bill.
Thanks very much. Now call on Neil Findlay. Mr Findlay, 9 minutes, please.
Hey, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to be opening this debate on behalf of the Labour Party. And I'm pleased that the government has got round to introducing this bill, because the debate has been a long time coming. I submitted my draft proposal for the Lobbying Transparency Scotland Bill in July 2012, and it's only now coming before this Parliament. But we've got there. We've got there, and that's a good thing. And we will support the principles of the bill at decision time tonight. Like others, I believe lobbying is a good thing. It informs debate. It assists the democratic process. For example, the briefings that we all received for this debate and others are often invaluable, and they provide information and expertise and knowledge and give different perspectives from a range of opinions, and they enhance our democracy, and that's a good thing. But, Presiding Officer, the workings of this Parliament and the way in which legislation is made, in which public contracts are awarded, etc., should all be open to scrutiny, and they should be transparent, including any lobbying that has occurred in the process. Because we know that the general standing of politics and those who work in and around it, following the expenses, scandals, cash for questions, taxes for hire, and current financial and the current financial controversies of some MPs is not high. Thankfully, this Parliament has been largely free of those types of scandals, and long may that continue. Indeed, the reason for bringing my bill forward was to put in place systems to ensure that we prevent such things from happening, thus protecting our democracy and this Parliament and those who engage with it. It would only take one or two scandals to really damage the standing of this Parliament, and that would be a major setback for all of us and for this institution. So a good, robust, workable lobbying bill fits with the preventative agenda that the government promotes, and I think that all of us support. But it's hard to deny the view of many that powerful interests enjoy disproportionate access to government and politicians over ordinary people, and that those interests have a disproportionate level of access to decision makers and influence over policy and the legislative process that the average man or woman in the street don't have. And if we look at currently, we could pick a whole range of issues, but if you look at organisations engaged in promoting renewable energy or fracking or air passenger duty cuts or airport expansion or a whole range of other issues and other matters, they're regularly spending very significant amounts of time and money and effort to get what they want. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, nothing wrong at all. They're perfectly entitled to do so. But the public should have a right to know who they're speaking to, what the reason was for those communications, and what, if any, was the outcome. This is not revolutionary stuff. It fits in with the founding principles of this Parliament. And so, Presiding Officer, I think this bill is absolutely timely and appropriate. New powers are coming to this place, and we know that with new powers lobbying follows. There was almost no Scottish lobbying industry to off note before this Parliament existed. And as powers have come, then lobbying activity has increased. And now lobbying goes on in this place every minute of every day. Again, I stress, that is not a bad thing. But it's right that we legislate now, and that we legislate in an atmosphere of relative calm, not in the wake of any scandal, when clearly, at that point, party political advantage would inevitably influence our discussions and our decisions. But, Presiding Officer, if we are to legislate, then it's my view that it must be done properly. Currently, as the bill stands, it is in need of radical amendment, in my opinion, to make it fit for purpose. And I'm pleased that colleagues from all parties on the Standards Committee recognise some of the major flaws in the Government's proposal and the need for improvement. And one of those flaws is that issue of face-to-face meetings between the lobbyist and the lobbied. And first reading the Government's proposal, I immediately thought, well, whether the Government think we still live in the 19th century, where telecommunications and computers don't exist. I see the Minister with a biro pen there, or a fancy pen. I'm assuming he doesn't write with a quill and parchment paper. I'm sure he doesn't send smoke signals. I'm sure he doesn't speak to people via two bean cans tied together with string. The Government says it wants to deliver an economy that is future-proofed and with world-class connectivity. Well, with that comes these newfangled gimmicks with such strange names as the telephone, the computer, email, conference call, video conference, for heaven's sake, Skype and FaceTime. I mean, I can hear the Minister muttering, oh, it doesn't matter, these will never catch on. Sorry.
Thank you. I mean,
Cabinet Secretary.
Government does not in any way not recognise these other forms of lobbying. Indeed, the bill allows for the Parliament to put in place guidance for those other forms of lobbying. But what we're saying is a line needs to be drawn in terms of what is regulated lobbying, in terms of where there is a criminal offence, and other lobbying for which there is guidance. So nobody's suggesting there isn't, these other forms of lobbying don't exist. Nobody's suggesting that we don't have email or telephones, but it's just about where you draw the line in terms of that regulation.
Neil Fenley.
Thank you, Minister, for confirming there, for he's not a Luddite, and that he is a modern man in the modern age, and I'm sure that he will want to ensure that this bill is a modern bill for the modern age, and that the Government will come back at stage two with a new definition of what is regulated lobbying. As Professor Raj Chari said during the committee evidence session, he had never seen this sort of wording before. It pains me to say that even the UK Government recognises that lobbying takes place by way of written communication. Now, I'm sure the Minister does not want to be compared unfavourably with the dog's breakfast that is the UK Lobbying Act. And we want a better proposal than what is there. So I think we must recognise the absurdity of that and fix that as soon as possible. We also need to address the weaknesses about who should be included in the register as having been lobbied. We all know here how lobbyists target special advisers and civil servants. These must be included in the proposals. Not to do so, I think, would leave a glaring loophole easily exploited. And the Minister referred to the SALT briefing that we had. If you look at the polling that they did on this, 91% of the public believe SPADs and civil servants must be included in the register. I hope the Minister will take account of that. And there's no mention either of financial disclosure. Surely if we want people to have faith in the system, it's vital that we know the scale of the lobbying. Are people spending a fiver or £5,000? That tells you the scale of the lobbying that goes on, and 92% of people support that as well. And for that, I think we need thresholds to ensure that normal MSP contact is unaffected, that one-off or infrequent lobbying is not included, and that only significant lobbying by those investing significant amounts of money and time to influence policies or win contracts are included in any register. Failure to make this clear has led to the fears that all activities for anyone approaching parliamentarians would have to be registered. And that was never the intention, and I hope it is not the Government's intention, and I'm sure it's not. My original proposals also suggested that the working career of lobbyists should also be included in the register, because too often we see the revolving door in operation, where ex-politicians, special advisers, civil servants move into a new role and with a short period of time open up their contact book to gain access to decision makers using all the knowledge and the relationships they've built up in their previous employment to influence policy or win contracts for their new clients or bosses. This again can lead to negative perceptions amongst the public, yet there is no mention of a revolving door clause in the government's proposals. And we only need to see what happened with recent governments of all persuasion at Westminster. We look at the current government and we look at the new recruits at Aberdeen Asset Management, Weber Shandwick, Charlotte Street Partners. We see all of that in action here. And as I said, this happened at Westminster under governments of all persuasion. So the reality is, Presiding Officer, I think this is a bill that has many flaws in it, and some of it is a bit of a mess. At a seminar I attended recently to discuss this, as did the committee convener, an expert on lobbying, an independent expert, said that at best he would give it a 2 out of 10. And he said the US system was a 6 out of 10. That does not bode well for the bill's transparency claims. So if this bill is to work and enhance our democracy, I think it needs serious amendment, and at stage two, we would intend to put forward many of those amendments. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Cameron Buchanan. 6 minutes or so, please, Mr. Buchanan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too am glad that we've got the chance to debate the lobbying bill and all its possible routes to take today. If we are to achieve cross-party consensus that the Scottish Government seek on this issue, we can and should examine each of the main points considered during our committee's inquiry and raised in our report. It is, however, essential that we maintain a firm focus on the three principles that must underline this bill if it is to be fair, effective and worthwhile. The first, of course, is transparency. Indeed, it could be right to say that the whole point of a lobbying register would be to increase transparency. It is vital that both the lobbying process and the breadth of the bill itself are clear. As well as this, we must ensure that any lobbying register upholds the principle of accessibility, and this is essential so that those who wish to participate in the public decision-making are not deterred from so doing, and I think this is a fundamental point. Finally, any registration requirements must be proportionate if they are to be fair and worthwhile, a point that has already been covered. This question of proportionality touches on a number of subjects that the committee has raised, including the types of communications of which officials should be counted. I don't think we should be specifying the type because there are all sorts of modern methods coming in. The first thing to be said is whatever form the bill takes in its final version, all of the implications and requirements must be clearly understood by all. This means that any provisions must be examined in depth and publicly so that indirect consequences are considered at length. Transparency also requires a transparent approach to deciding on the bill itself so the public can understand the direction and be prepared for any new system. To help achieve this, we must ensure, I think, that the key provisions of the bill are set in Parliament and not left to be decided by secondary legislation. I realise that we're now just at stage one at the moment, but the point I am making is that ease of understanding the bill must not be an afterthought or we'll end up with a stifling bill and also a lawyer's paradise. An example of an area we need to clarify, I think, is the exemption where meetings are not initiated by the lobbyist. Part of this public understanding concerns just how much preparation or adjustment would be needed, which touches on two other principles I want to mention, that of accessibility and proportionality. I think we could all agree that the involvement of expert organisations, members of the public and affected parties in the public policy process is a welcome and indeed necessary feature of our political system. To make informed decisions, obviously, they have to be informed in the first place. We must therefore keep a focus on ensuring that accessibility to the public is neither made more difficult nor discouraged in the first place. And this has been highlighted many times in committee and by evidence. I say the public on purpose because the issue of lobbying is not one of backroom deals between special interests and brokers of power, as it is sometimes portrayed. It has a rather dirty name, lobbying, sometimes. But rather so much as a more fundamental matter of the chance for everyone to participate in policy making and the exchange of ideas. All manner of organisations and members of the public can and should feel welcome to discuss matters of interest with their representatives. As for proportionality, I'm quite clear that any potential system of lobbying registration has to be light touch. This ties in with the importance of accessibility and is worth raising a couple of more specific points. Firstly, the committee has pointed out that it is worth looking into the inclusion of all forms of communication in the bill, as well as contact with senior civil servants and special advisers. I personally do see where these demands are coming from, but I don't think we should lose sight of the need to strike a balance between increasing transparency where there's needed and ensuring that the individuals and organisations are not deterred or put off from participating in the political process due to undue regulation and overcomplicating. We must also have concerns about the inclusion of contact with MSPs in the register. I think we'd probably be dealing with that in stage two, as we would need to make sure that their ability to undertake their duties as public representatives is not restricted. Politics conducted on behalf of the public should, after all, be open to easy access for the public. Suggestions to use a targeted approach based on the intensity of lobbying activity rather than at its source are also a welcome idea worth exploring. Secondly, proportionality should be measured relative to the benefit to be gained or the problem to be solved. This suggests the need to understand how undue influence may arise and therefore where requirements should be targeted. Now, thankfully, we've not been troubled by lobbying scandals in our political system, but this does not mean that we might not be. It begs the question also is how much needs to be done. I'm not saying that we shouldn't do anything. On the contrary, I think the measure of what we should do should be proportionate and should be understanding that the bill would consider what is potential rather than the pressing problem. If these principles are upheld, I believe a fair, effective and worthwhile system of regulation of lobbying can be found. To do this, we have to continue to scrutinise each proposition in depth and ensure that the principles are acted upon rather than lip service paid to them. I will touch on this more detail later, and I look forward to discussing all aspects of this with colleagues across the chamber. Thank you.
Thank you. We now turn to the open debate, speeches of 6 minutes or so. There is a bit of time in hand at this stage for interventions, and I call George Adam to be followed by Cara Hilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was a member of the Standards Committee during the original inquiry into lobbying and for most of the work that was completed up until this point. Recently I left the committee, but for some reason I keep getting drawn back, or is that dragged back into this debate? And what I'm going to discuss is my very personal views, since I've actually had time to sit back from my work in the committee and look at some of the information. And I do believe that all democracy should be transparent and open, but let me make it clear at this point I do support the bill. At the same time, I have a number of issues with it. There are a number of practicalities to do with our day-to-day constituency and parliamentary life, which our colleague already mentioned, and I feel the proposals could make this more difficult. At this point, I would like to take you back to 1997, when many of us were all working together to ensure that this institution came into being. And I remember trying to download the Scotland Bill White Paper from the web with my 14.4K modem. After 24 hours of waiting and a worried visit from my mother-in-law as to why my phone was engaged for 24 hours, I went down to the local bookshop and bought a hard copy. From then till now, and during the lifetime of this Parliament, Scotland and the world has changed dramatically. Now we have super-fast broadband, but in Paisley, that bookstore is no longer there. How could a third or fourth generation family business compete with the web when you can purchase a hard copy or an e-copy from home and instantly get it delivered or to your door? So although it appears that advancement for the consumer is good, something has been lost. Progress has lost something important in life. And this is the point I'm trying to make with regards to the lobbying bill. We need to be very careful we don't lose the many strengths the Scottish Parliament has with the feeling that something has to be done about lobbying. I appreciate that many look to Westminster and see their legislation has not helped in any way and was a knee-jerk reaction to some of the strange workings of that Parliament. But should we not look at that reaction and take note? During all the evidence that the committee heard, this legislation was slated for being useless. We were told that Westminster and Washington were among the worst for transparency, and both already have legislated for lobbying. Presiding Officer, I know I get a hard time from colleagues regarding my great pride in being Paisley's member of the Scottish Parliament, and I take that in good humour. But the serious point for me is how I deliver for my constituents and how I interact with their employers, the public sector and the third sector on their behalf. Can I just get this point across, Mr Finlay? As this bill currently stands, it will be made difficult for local employers and small businesses to contact me. Some SMEs may not even bother because they will wonder if it would be worth the hassle to register and come and have a meaningful dialogue with their elected member. It's stated that the register should be targeted at organisations who have significant contact with their MSPs. Now, one small engineering business locally came to me to discuss an expansion which would create jobs in the area as well. How they would take the next big step and could I help them or point them in the right direction? Now, that same business may have looked at a different way of dealing with things and may not have approached an elected member if they thought there was an administrative barrier for them to actually do that. Larger businesses, major employers, does that mean that every single major employer in Renfrewshire has to register and record every single meeting that they have with an elected member as we discuss the future of my constituents and their job? And as it stands, there would be an added burden put upon the third sector to register. One of the best things about the Scottish Parliament would be lost. The institution of Scotland's Parliament, and we take all the great pride in the openness and accessibility of our members, ministers and government, and that is something worth preserving. I'm aware that many of the MSPs' intake from 1999 originally looked at the workings of the Parliament and looked at lobbying and how to deal with it, and I'm aware that they knew that this could cause harm to their vision for the future.
Neil Findlay.
Mr Adam is making an argument, a very good argument, for us to actually have thresholds that would mean that all of those people that he talks about, or the vast majority of them, don't need to register at all. That's the argument that he's making.
George Adam.
I'm making the argument that I can represent the people of Paisley and make sure that I can still have the interaction and the flexibility to be doing that. So don't get me wrong, openness and transparency in politics and us delivering for our constituency is the most important thing. But one of the issues that constantly came up, and it's happened in this debate as well, was an inquiry, was the fact that how do you define lobbyists? Now, the Spice paper we received was quite interesting as well, because it confuses the issue even more. It's got lobbying activity can be conducted through a number of direct or indirect communication methods, including personal letters, telephone, email, forms of social media, such as Twitter, Facebook, and providing briefing material to members, organisation meetings and rallies. So lobbyists come from various sectors, including individual members of the public, groups of constituents, local business, organised pressure groups, campaigners, or commercial organisations. That presiding officer is just about everyone. So when we look at that, we need to find out who we're actually calling a lobbyist at this stage. So how do we actually take this to the next stage? And the funny thing was that when you looked at the UK Lobbying Act, they got accused that their definition was too narrow. They didn't actually include enough people. And actually, many of the lobbyist firms were still getting the opportunity to go without getting caught, to be brought up with the net. So since this bill is our direction of travel, I want two things from it. I want to be able to represent my constituents and work with other organisations to try and make my constituency a better place to live in. I don't want an administrative straitjacket. And finally, and most importantly, I don't want to lose sight of the founding principles of this Parliament. If we lose them, then, like that family-run bookstore, we won't get it back.
Thank you. I now call Cara Hilton to be followed by Fiona MacLeod.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have the chance to speak in today's debate, and can I begin by commending my Scottish Labour colleague Neil Findlay for proposing this bill back in 2012 and for his patience over the past few years as the bill has been considered by the Standards and Procedures Committee and then finally taken on board by the Scottish Government. As a member of the Standards Committee during the original inquiry, I've taken a keen interest in the bill, and it's good to see that we're finally seeing some progress in this important area. The Electoral Reform Society has said that today's debate could either place Scotland as a world leader in transparent politics or create legislation which leaves Parliament vulnerable to lobbying scandals. And in this context, I do have serious concerns that the bill as it stands is just too weak. And Stuart Stevenson highlighted some of the concerns expressed by the current Standards Committee. So that I hope that when the next time we discuss this bill in the Chamber, it will have been strengthened considerably. And I'm pleased to hear the Minister say that he's got an open mind on this. At Holyrood, we quite rightly pride ourselves on being different from Westminster, more open, more accountable and more accessible to all. And while today Holyrood has been pretty much free of any lobbying scandals, this isn't a reason not to act. This bill isn't about preventing lobbying. As Neil Findlay has said, lobbying is a good thing. It is an important part of our democratic process. Indeed, it often improves public policy outcomes. It informs our debates. It provides valuable information and expertise. And it improves public engagement with the Parliament. But lobbying has got to be open, transparent, and it's got to be conducted to the highest possible standards, not behind closed doors and in secret. I suspect this could be the first and last time I'll ever quote David Cameron, but he hit the nail on the head when he described lobbying as the next big scandal waiting to happen, an issue that exposes the far too cosy relationship between politics, government, business and money. And with the new powers on the way to Holyrood, the ability to raise and spend more finance, we're going to inevitably see more frequent and more intense lobbying. At a time when the decisions being made by both the Scottish Parliament and government are coming under increasing public scrutiny, when our communities are paying the price of austerity and cuts to public services, job losses and pay freezes, as a result of the decisions politicians are taking at all levels, we should be leading the way in ensuring that the decisions that we take here and in the workings of our Parliament and our government are as open and transparent as possible. And we should be using this opportunity to pass world-leading legislation, not as a response to scandal, as has been the case elsewhere, but because we want to show the citizens of Scotland that the Scottish Parliament will always put people first, not the interests of commercial or other vested interests. So I think that it's disappointing that rather than grasping this opportunity, the bill falls short of the change that we need to see. In its final report on the bill, the Standards Committee concluded that its narrow scope could leave a great deal of important information unrecorded and create a loophole for those wishing to conceal their activity. And I'm sure I'm not alone in receiving many emails from constituents over the past week urging action to close this loophole and strengthen the bill. So as Neil Findlay has said, we will be amending the bill at stage two to make it more robust and more fit for purpose. A recent poll by YouGov on behalf of the Scottish Alliance for Lobbying Transparency found that 88% of voters thought a lack of transparency about lobbying was either a big or significant risk to Scottish democracy. And calls for the current proposals to be strengthened could not be clearer, with 86% wanting emails to be covered, 91% wanting senior civil servants to be covered, and 92% wanted to know how much lobbyists are spending on their campaigns. This poll provides concrete evidence of the public desire to ensure a robust and transparent lobbying register in Scotland, not the halfway house that's been proposed today. So I hope that the government will take into account the real strength of public feeling on the issue, listening to the demand for transparency about how money and lobbying influence politics in Scotland, and agree to the changes that both Scottish Labour, the committee and the majority of the public want to see. Deputy Presiding Officer, today's debate is about strengthening our democracy. And to coin a phrase from the SNP, it's about making our democracy stronger for Scotland. We've got the honour to serve our constituents here in Parliament, and in return, we've got a duty to ensure that the Parliament, the government and its decisions are as open and transparent as possible. It's in all our interest to ensure that we get this legislation right, so let's ensure that when the bill comes back to the Chamber, the bill we debate is stronger and more effective. Strengthened to include all lobbying, not just face-to-face contact. Strengthened to include not just MSPs and ministers, but civil servants and special advisers too. Strengthened to require financial disclosure of lobbying, but with thresholds so that normal MSP contact is unaffected. And strengthened to recognise the revolving door in politics, to give the public the right to know the work history of lobbyists. We are rightly proud of our Parliament, but we can't pretend that it's immune from corporate power or influence. In the Scottish public, I've got the right to know and the right to see the full extent of the lobbying on the issues that affect everybody's lives. Scotland has got to lead the way on transparency, and I will conclude once again by commending Neil Findlay for his tremendous work on this issue to help ensure that our democracy is truly fit for the 21st century.
Thank you. I now call Fiona MacLeod to be followed by Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say that my starting point when I come to look at the lobbying bill is this Parliament's founding principles, not just the founding principles back in 1999, but the reputation that we have garnered over the last 17 years of our existence. And those founding principles were about us being open and about being transparent, because what we wanted was that this would be Scotland's Parliament, not the MSP's Parliament, that we would work in partnership with the people of Scotland and with Civic Scotland. And when I look round the chamber today at those taking part in the debate, I know it's myself, Elaine Murray and Gil Paterson, who I think will feel that most strongly from those heady days when we were so enthusiastic about what we were setting out to do in 1999. But as I say, I think this Parliament, 17 years on, has a well-credited reputation in being that open and transparent Parliament that works in partnership. And that is reflected in the two reports of the SPPA committee. In 2014, when I was a member of the committee, we took extensive evidence on lobbying after the introduction of Mr. Findlay's Members' Bill. And then, of course, more recently, when I wasn't a member, I've just come back, there was evidence taken for the stage one process of this bill. Both those reports of the Standards Committee found no evidence of malpractice, and I think that's an important point that we make in this debate, and I'm glad that everybody has made that debate, that point. But we're not complacent, and I don't want anybody to think that if people are suggesting that the bill goes far enough or doesn't go far enough, that it's through complacency, but it's about how we ensure that this Parliament maintains its high reputation. So there is no complacency, the reports found no complacency, and therefore we came along the process from a member's bill to a government bill, very much influenced by the evidence of that first report of the Standards Committee, it would appear to me. Because when you look at the clear principles that the Minister talked about in framing the bill, about being proportionate, about being complementary, and about ensuring that it does not interfere with the engagement of which this Parliament is so proud. So I then looked at the bill and said, does the bill match those principles? And for the first principle on proportionate and the third one on ensuring that we continue with engagement, if you look at some of the evidence we've received, it gives me some concerns that we don't go too far. For example, the Epilepsy Consortium in Scotland, if I can quote from their evidence, any regulation of lobbyists in Scotland should be specifically formed to reflect the culture of political participation in Scotland and the particular working practices of the Scottish Parliament. We believe, that's the Epilepsy Consortium Scotland, it must not create a barrier to parliamentary engagement for organisations representing the most vulnerable and disadvantaged members of our society. I then looked at the evidence from the SCVO, and again, if I may quote, transparency of lobbying in Scotland is a relevant and laudable goal, but protecting participation is absolutely vital and must take precedence, especially as it has been conceded on numerous occasions that there is no problem with undue influence of lobbying in Scotland. Sabotaging the high levels of participation in Scotland to achieve hypothetical increases in transparency would be a tragedy for democracy and must be avoided.
Of course. Neil Findlay.
I think that's an interesting point she raises about SCVO, because during the consultation when I introduced my bill, SCVO were the most vocal opponents of that bill for some bizarre reason. I have no idea why. But when I scratched a little bit further, many members of SCVO were actually in favour of the bill, and that the submission they put into my bill was only for 11 members of SCVO who represent thousands of the organisation. Only 11 opposed the bill.
Fiona McLeod, and you can have the time back.
I well remember that day in taking evidence in the committee, Mr Findlay, and I remember you being rebuked by the convener at the time for your manner. But what I would say is that from that evidence that SCVO submitted, we have, of course, and it's been referred to in the chamber, over the last couple of weeks, a lot of other organisations, including SCVO, with updated evidence, have been back in touch with them, again, all maintaining. And I go back to what I said when I started. It's not that we shouldn't have the bill. It's my concern, my huge concern when looking at it is that we protect and ensure that the founding principles of openness and transparency, that reputation we've built up of partnership working, that we don't bring in a bill that in any way prevents that reputation from continuing as it is. One of the other areas that the committee looked at in greater detail this time when taking evidence for the stage one of the bill was extending the regulation to all communications, and it's already been discussed by a number of members. And you will notice in the committee's report on the stage one that it was not a unanimous report on this area. And it was me that wasn't unanimous in extending it beyond face-to-face oral communications. And again, it's because of my concerns about could this become a barrier to that great partnership working that we've got with civic society, with our constituents, and with just groups of ordinary citizens that come together and get passionate about something. And I noticed in some of the submissions that have been made to us most recently in the last few days, Federation of Small Businesses, Cancer Research UK, and ASPA, which is a professional association for lobbyists. Now, there's the panoply of everybody involved in this saying that they have concerns about it being extended to all communications. And in the first report of the committee, when I was there to take all the evidence, at paragraph 107 in that report, the committee said, the proposed register does not seek to capture all contacts from organisations that are required to register. The committee wants to increase transparency, but considers that a system that requires a sensible amount of useful information from organisations can be established. And I keep coming back to that, a sensible amount of useful information. I think that's what we're looking at. And it was interesting, when we started to discuss, you know, extending beyond oral face-to-face communications, and we all think about, and we've had jokes about, are we in the 21st century with telephones and emails? But then we started thinking about, well, I started thinking about, what about Twitter and Facebook? You know, if we extend to all communications, are we into having to register tweets, posts, direct messaging? You know, so I want us to kind of think it all through.
Can you draw to a close, please?
Certainly. On the complementary strand of the principles, I would just draw the members' attention to the fact that we have a code of conduct, we have the Members' Interest Act, and our Standards Committee itself works really hard in producing rules and guidance, for example, on cross-party groups to ensure that we maintain that openness and transparency. So back to the beginning, founding principles of this Parliament, 17 years of positive engagement. So at stage one, yes, we agree the principles of the bill, but at stage two, let's make sure that any amendments are about improvements and adjustments in response to the evidence, but maintaining the openness of this Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Elaine Murray, to be followed by Gil Paterson.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And unlike others who have taken part in this debate, I am not on the committee which considered the arguments around it. And I've read both the Spice report and the committee's Stage 1 report with considerable interest. Lobbying is, as others have said, an acceptable activity. Indeed, it's a necessary activity which contributes to parliamentary discussion and knowledge. It is carried out legitimately by a wide range of organisations and individuals. Unfortunately, the term lobbying now carries some negative connotations due to disreputable activity by some organisations and some parliamentarians, though I hasten to add not by members of this Parliament. It is transparency over lobbying activity which is required, not the prevention of lobbying itself. Third sector organisations, trade unions, private businesses, public organisations must remain able to participate in discussion around the matters which this Parliament is considering. Credit should be given to my colleague Neil Findlay for initiating this legislation by lodging proposals for his members' bill back in July 2012. His proposals would have required individuals and organisations who lobby MSPs, Scottish ministers and public officials to record and publish information on their activities. And it has taken some time for his proposals to be progressed, but I am pleased to see that they are being progressed now. The Scottish Government undertook to take over Neil's members' bill. That was welcomed, but I think there are significant questions regarding whether this bill, as it stands at stage one, is sufficiently robust to ensure public confidence in who is influencing our decisions. For example, registration of lobbying activity is not extended to senior civil servants and officials or special advisers. These individuals have significant influence over policy making. They may be involved in drafting legislation or in advising ministers on how to present proposed action. It could well be more effective for a lobbyist to influence senior civil servants or advisers than to contact ministers or MSPs themselves. This, I believe, is a glaring omission from the bill, and I was pleased to note that the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee have recommended that the definition should be broadened to include public officials. The bill is also deficient in that it only covers face-to-face oral communications, as others have already mentioned. We all know that this is not the only way in which we are lobbied. We receive emails on a daily basis from organisations wishing to influence our views on legislation and other matters. I often receive letters sent by professional lobbyists on behalf, for example, of companies wishing to build wind farms in my constituency, and it has not been unknown for professional lobbyists to phone me up on behalf of their clients. These alternative forms of communications can be just as effective as face-to-face meetings. Indeed, written communications may indeed be preferable in presenting the arguments for a proposal. So it does seem peculiar that these forms of lobbying are not included in the scope of this bill. Another key part of Neil Findlay's proposed members' bill was transparency over the amount of money being spent on lobbying. As the financial aspects of lobbying are of particular public interest, this information should be publicly available. I appreciate that there are sensitivities in case its information reveals details of paid lobbyist salaries. Neil Findlay suggested to the committee that these sensitivities might be addressed, or at least in part, by using a system of banding. However, you know, our salaries as MSPs and any additional income which we receive have to be declared. They are publicly known. That is quite correct. The salaries and salary bands of public officials are published. And I find it difficult to be oversympathetic to the view that the funding of lobbying activity should not be treated similarly. There are other potential loopholes with the proposals too. Large, well-funded NGOs could get around the requirement for registration by using volunteers rather than paid staff to undertake, while having the materials and events supporting the activities of those volunteers prepared and organised by those paid staff. And also, pro bono lobbying by professional lobbyists would also not be required to be registered. I also want to support Neil Findlay's suggestion that the public ought to know whether former politicians, advisers and civil servants are using the contacts they established when in office in order to subsequently make money for themselves or for other employers by lobbying. While in office or while advising people in office, these people are paid by the public purse. It is, you know, taxpayers' money which is being used on these salaries. And if they're using the contacts they made while being paid by the public purse in order to make money for themselves or for others, surely, and to try to influence their successor politicians and advisers, surely actually the public should know that that is happening and that they should know how much that is happening. And I think that actually is a matter of public confidence also. The issue of thresholds should also be examined at stage two, because small businesses who contact their local MSP, for example, shouldn't necessarily fall within the scope of this bill. I can give very current examples. I mean, during the recent floods in Dumfries, where a lot of small businesses along the White Sands and Friars Venel were adversely affected by flooding, I met a significant number of small businesses who spoke to me about flood defences, who spoke to me about insurance and whether or not there might be assistance with them getting back on their feet and so on. I don't think that they should have to register the fact they bumped into me in the street and had a conversation about something which was pertinent to their business, but was actually really just a one-off. So I wouldn't want those sort of businesses to be involved in the registration process for that type of activity. In conclusion, there is still a lot of work to be done to improve this bill, and I hope and I believe that ministers are listening carefully to the committee's suggestions and indeed to the suggestions which are being made in today's debate. And I'm sure that the committee will have very interesting and full discussions at stage two and at stage three when this bill goes further. Thank you.
Thank you. Gil Paterson.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. I well remember the first Parliament in 1999.
Mr Patterson, could you lift up your microphone?
I'll start again, Presiding Officer. I well remember the first Parliament in 1999 that the expectation and drive was to create an open and accessible institution different to what was being experienced at Westminster. People, ordinary people, whether individuals or part of an organisation, were invited and encouraged to engage with the Parliament. For me, one of the best aspects of the action for engagement, which was pretty much universally driven by members of all parties, the parties themselves, the Scottish Executive, and even the parliamentary authorities, was how the third sector positively reacted to the invitation. I can see no less encouragement from the present Parliament complement, including the Scottish Government, for the public, along with the third sector, to positively engage with us. For my part, I had a members' debate on men's violence against women and children early on in the first Parliament. In fact, it was the first year, which attracted substantial numbers of women, individuals and many from the third sector who were engaged in one way or another with the issue debated. We all met directly after the debate for a chat. It was quickly agreed to set up a cross-party group on men's violence against women and children, and we met six or so weeks later, and I'm pleased to say the cross-party group is still going strong and thriving now. I would say that any person from then until now who are engaged in this area of concern, that they are all lobbyists in some form or another. And under the definition suggested by the SPPA committee, all the groups like Women's Aid, Rape Crisis, Open Secret and many more will be required to register simply because they have people who are paid. Now, as far as I am aware, none of these third sector organisations that I have mentioned have somebody who is a paid lobbyist. Nevertheless, I could not in all honesty say that they don't lobby. And while I'm at it, what's the difference between lobbying and campaigning? For if it was not for the persistent and dedicated campaigning, or is it lobbying, over decades, by which I should point out where and is predominantly by women, we would still be in the dark ages regards to the matters that significantly affect women and children. I raised the question of officials. Just hold on a minute. I raised the question of officials. Would someone, for instance, who was a paid worker, say in Rape Crisis, be regarded as a lobbyist? The answer was yes. I also asked the officials that since the new recommendation from the SPPA committee was to ask the Scottish Government to consider that all communications of any kind would constitute a requirement to register, when should an individual who, because they are paid, is a lobbyist, say from Rape Crisis, and who sent me a Christmas card, this would require them to register, since the definition is all communications of all kind. The answer was yes. You may well laugh, but that's the advice that I was given. So we need to be really, really careful, really, really careful how we describe these things and how it's going to affect them. Mr. Finlay.
Neil Finlay.
I've seen it in many, and shoals of red herrings being released in this debate, but that is the biggest, that's a blue whale of a red herring, that one, that sending a Christmas card is lobbying. Come on. However, even if the scenario he paints about the Rape Crisis scene, and I would certainly hope that that type of incidental lobbying would not be included in the final bill, even if it were, then it would mean someone taking 2 minutes to fill in a piece of paper. That's the burden we're talking about. However, what he does do is he makes a very strong case for putting thresholds in, and I agree with him on that.
Gil Paterson.
Well, I know that you were laughing, Mr. Finlay, but I'll tell you this, your colleague that's sitting next to you didn't laugh when I raised the question at the committee, and that was the answer that was given. So what I'm actually saying here, you know, I'm not against a lobbyist in taking on the big guys. It's the small women I'm looking after here in the small institutions, and we need to be really, really careful how we actually use the definitions, and I'll go on to explain that further. Now, I know that many, many of these women's organisations put enormous amounts of time, relatively speaking, to find funds to simply keep going, and they are not in a position to afford any slack, so adding a further burden on them would, in my opinion, be detrimental to them. But now, more importantly, why would we want to place them in a category of lobbyists in the first place? Surely these are the very organisations we want to make it easy for us to engage with. Again, I go on.
Neil Finlay.
I greatly appreciate that, Mr. Paterson. In my consultation, Women's Aid supported the lobbying bill that I put forward.
Gil Paterson.
I'm not speaking for Women's Aid or anybody else. These are my own words, and I'm talking about the impact it's going to have in all these organisations. I've also sponsored a members' debate twice for the Scottish Cot Death Trust. This is a tiny, small organisation that does, in my opinion, some of the most difficult work one could ever want to imagine. Do they lobby? Of course they do. But what do they lobby for? It's not about money. It's not about resources, Presiding Officer. Do you know what they really lobby for? It's for awareness, to inform the public, to assist families through some of the most harrowing times of their lives, and also to inform and educate on preventative action. That's what they lobby for. Why would we want to cause them not to engage with this Parliament? I would ask the Government and indeed the whole Parliament to consider the definitions extremely carefully indeed. The bill must be for lobbyists, those that make a living by lobbying. That is those who are paid to lobby, not those who get paid in the third sector, which could be an organisation with as little as one paid member of staff who happens to seek our assistance to help others. Nor should it be all communications of any kind. I just happen to like getting Christmas cards. Presiding Officer, whatever we do in this regard, it should be done taking account of the slowest ship in the convoy. The part of this convoy that needs our protection most is the voluntary sector, like women's groups that I have described. They and we need engagement, and I agree with the principles of the bill. Thank you.
Many thanks. We now turn to the closing speeches, and I call on Cameron Buchanan. 7 minutes, please, Mr. Buchanan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There have been many interesting points raised in this afternoon's debate. I'll first of all say that I hope that open, respectful discussion continues so we can settle the issues surrounding this lobbying bill. Most of us just disagree in the detail rather than the actual substance of it. There are a few more points, however, which I wish to raise that we'll be looking at as we continue to scrutinise the bill, which includes some of the finer details about ensuring the burden of regulation is kept proportionate and the requirements are realistic in practice. Some arguments have been made to force lobbyists to disclose financial expenditure on lobbying, which are worth airing, but I think would fail the proportionality test. On the other hand, there is a scope to embed a more proportionate approach to the system by continually reviewing the proposed frequency of submissions to the register so that paperwork is kept to a strict minimum. It's also worth highlighting that there are many international comparators when it comes to lobbying requests, and I think we'd do well to study their lessons. We Conservatives will certainly do that as we scrutinise the bill, including examination of the possibility of working with the UK Register so that overall burden on organisations is minimised. Members would be aware that some arguments have been made that lobbyists should be forced to disclose their expenditure on lobbying activity. I believe, however, that such a move would not be productive and would in fact cause some problems without any proportional benefit. Assigning all expenditure to certain activity could be difficult for some organisations, and efforts to comply may result in unintentionally misleading figures that are simply counterproductive, not to mention implications for commercial sensitivity and confidentiality. These risks, I think, are associated with the high costs of compliance, point to negatives that outweigh suggested gains of enforced financial disclosure. Since there have thankfully been no cash for lobbying scandals so far in our politics, I fear that such a move would be pandering to perceptions rather than reality. Indeed, where such complex requirements exist, it may be the case that small businesses simply just disengage from the political process rather than risk falling foul of complicated guidance. Another detail I think that will be debated as the scrutiny of this bill continues is the requirement for information returns to the lobbying register, or more specifically, their frequency. As the bill stands, such returns would be required every 6 months, which I think strikes an appropriate balance between information and proportionality. I certainly wouldn't want to see organisations and individuals forced to make returns on a very frequent basis. Having said that, I do think there could be scope to have a flexible system of information returns that varies according to factors such as lobbying intensity, size and form. I don't wish to advocate such a multi-tiered system today, but I'd merely suggest that it is worth looking at as our consideration of the bill continues. It may be the case that such a system would be impractical, but I don't think there's any harm in discussing the ideas. On a different note, for a bill with many points of contention and wide range of options, it is so important that we study international comparators such as Ireland's Register of Lobbying and the EU's Transparency Register. In Ireland, for example, there was a trial run of the new register before it came to legal effect to help organisations adapt to the requirement, which I think may be worth considering here to reduce regulatory pressure. In the EU, there are a series of incentives for the lobbyists who register compared to those who do not, such as increased access to premises and automatic mail notification of new consultations. Again, this is just an idea worth exploring. I think we would do well to learn as much as we can from these examples if we choose to go our own way, and we're doing it so that we do it from an informed position. Finally, I would like to leave colleagues with a thought on what the ultimate aim of any lobbying regulation is. It is not to create the most watertight lobbying register in the world. That's just the method. The ultimate and real aim is to ensure that our politics and government is transparent, open and accountable, free from undue influence or corruption. There are many routes to take when it comes to lobbying regulation, but the ultimate responsibility lies with the politicians and officials themselves. Compliance with codes of conduct, adherence to the standards expected in public office, and outright refusal to indulge attempts at illegitimate influence are the strongest defence of a free political system. We would do well to remember that.
Thank you. I now call on Mary Fee, 8 minutes or so, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In closing this debate for Scottish Labour, I'd like to take this opportunity to summarise the two arguments made by my colleagues and clearly state our position on the Lobbying Scotland Bill. Scottish Labour supports the general principles of the bill in trying to promote greater transparency, accountability and openness amongst our parliamentarians. We agree that lobbying is a legitimate and valuable activity. We support the proposal of establishing a lobbying register. And we also support the proposal to include only paid lobbyists on this register. However, as Neil Findlay in his opening remarks highlighted, the bill as drafted falls far short of his original proposal. And indeed, the bill as currently drafted is in danger of making the situation worse, not better. We need to ensure that this bill is fit for purpose and does what it is intended to do and is currently drafted, it will not. Cara Hilton in her contribution raised issues around the weakness of the bill and the potential risk of vulnerability for those involved. Elaine Murray highlighted the fact that lobbying is a necessary and legitimate activity, but does need robust regulation. Other colleagues across the chamber spoke of the principle of openness and transparency and the need for robust legislation which is proportionate. And Cameron Buchanan, in both his opening and closing contributions, I think made very thoughtful and thorough speeches, adequately and fully reflecting the evidence that we heard in committee. Firstly, the bill only covers face-to-face lobbying, which means a great deal of lobbying is not covered by the bill. And as the majority of lobbying is conducted through email or telephone, there is a large part of the bill would not collect the right amount of information. And it is correct that face-to-face lobbying should be covered by the bill. However, for the bill to have any impact in improving the transparency of Parliament, all forms of communication with MSPs, such as email and telephone, should also be covered by the bill. The second key area where my colleagues have highlighted where the bill could be improved is through broadening the definition of lobbying. The bill at present does not include communications made to public officials, such as civil servants and special advisers, as was highlighted in my colleague Neil Findlay's opening contribution. And we in Scottish Labour believe that the definition of lobbying in the bill should also be broadened to include civil servants and special advisers. Special advisers hold a highly influential position over the decision-making of government ministers. And to make the Scottish Parliament as transparent, accountable and open as possible, the remit of this bill should extend to those individuals who have influence over our government. To broaden the remit of the bill to include civil servants and special advisers is rational, fair and does strengthen our democracy. And in looking to broaden the scope of lobbying covered by the bill, the government may wish to pay close attention to the definition which has been used by the Sunlight Foundation. And the definition of lobbying used by the Sunlight Foundation is as follows. Oral and written communication, including electronic communication, with an elected official
their staff or high-ranking and mid-ranking government employee who exercises public power or public authority for the purposes of influencing the formulation, modification, adoption or administration of legislation, rules, spending decisions or any other government programme, policy or position. And the evidence collected by the Standards Committee from witnesses was conclusive. There was a clear consensus that the bill simply does not go far enough. The Law Society of Scotland stated that the policy aim of transparency may only be partially met if other forms of communication were not included in the definition of lobbying in the bill. And in closing, I would urge the government to look into amending the bill to ensure that the bill covers all forms of communication between lobbyists and MSPs, and not just through face-to-face communication, and to ensure that the bill includes communications between civil servants or special advisers and MSPs. And only upon implementing these changes to the bill can we start to rebuild public confidence in elected politicians, which we all know is at probably an all-time low. And only upon implementing these changes to the bill can we then make the Scottish Parliament an institution renowned the world over for its transparency, accountability and openness. And can I close by confirming our in-principle support for the Lobbying Scotland Bill? Thank you.
Point of order, Presiding Officer.
Mr Finlay, a point of order. Could I have Mr Finlay's microphone?
In response to Mr Patterson, I said that it was Women's Aid who supported the proposal. Actually, the comments were from Zero Tolerance Scotland, and I just wanted to correct the record on that, who raised many positive comments about the bill, but incidentally raised many of the concerns that members are making as well.
Thank you, Mr Finlay. It's not a point of order, however. Your comments will be on the record for clarification. I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick to wind up the debate. Minister, we have quite a bit of time in hand until 5 o'clock. If you wish to take that time, otherwise the Parliament would have to be briefly suspended. Many
okay.
thanks.
I mean, thanks very much. And, I really do welcome the contributions from across the Chamber to this debate. As I said at the start, we as Government, we recognise that this bill is very much parliamentary in nature, which is why that we are trying to engage the way we want. I understand Mr Finlay's initial frustration that it appeared that we were taking longer than he might have liked to come forward with an actual bill, but I think it was absolutely appropriate that before we formulated our framework that we listened to the deliberations of the Standards and Public Procedures Appointments Committee after their inquiry. It was an inquiry which was instigated by the late Helen Eady, and I think as one of the founding members of this Parliament, Helen felt it was very important that Parliament had a large say in how this bill comes forward, which is why as I said in my opening remarks, the committee's report very much influenced the thinking of the government in taking this forward. So some of the decisions which people are questioning were very much influenced by the evidence that the committee got, the recommendations the committee took forward. But as I said also at the start, that's not to say this is a process we're in here in terms of the parliamentary process going through. This will be the end of stage one, but going through stage two and stage three, and we continue to listen to members. And today was, I think, very helpful in hearing some of the views across the chamber. I'm going to try and address some of the points that were brought up, if I can remember who they were. They were made by convener raised the issue, which I don't think I managed to get to in any great depth in my opening remarks, in relation to the exemption for meetings initiated by MSPs and ministers. Now, I think we all know that as members and in government also, we regularly invite people to provide us with factual information or background information or policy, and I think I would hope we all agree that that is important and that continues. And there's a question that whether it would appear to be fair that if we are inviting people to come in and give us information, that in order for them to give us information as members of Parliament or as ministers, that they should then have to register, and there's a real danger that we might request people to give us information and the potential they would be deterred in that engagement. But that said, I note the concerns expressed in the committee's Stage 1 report, and particularly the questions around how we can make sure there's as much clarity around that area as possible, and obviously we will look at that very carefully in advance of our response to the Stage 1 report. Neil Findlay talked about knowing the employment of the working careers of lobbyists, and I think he was particularly, I think, getting at former special advisers and maybe ministers. And in terms of those areas, the Advisory Committee on Business Appointments considers applications under the business appointment rules about new jobs for former ministers, senior civil servants and other Crown servants. But again, it's a point that we will consider going forward as to whether there is something in terms of improving clarity. I think the point to emphasise is, I think across the chamber, while there might appear to be different voices, I think we're all clear that we do want to come out with a bill which improves transparency in Scotland, and that's very much where we're at. And hopefully the process will help us to get to that point. Elaine Murray made a point regarding voluntary lobbying, and that was something that we considered, and our challenge was how we can cover that without catching the sort of lobbying of community, the advocates-type lobbying, community grassroots lobbying that I think we didn't want to catch. And that's why we've got the paid-unpaid definition. That was our reason for that being the starting point. However, the bill, recognising that there was a potential gap there, the bill does have provision to allow provision of additional information by those who are not required to register and to do so in a voluntary fashion. And I think one of the pieces of evidence which was quite interesting in the committee stage was, I think, from the Canadian experience, where the register is now regarding, has developed to have such regard that people want to make sure that their lobbying activity is on it. And if we can get to that point where that, you know, this is not seen in any way as onerous, it's seen as something you actually want to do, then I think we'll get to a better place. We'll have something that's far more useful. But I think we need to get to that point. Right now, I'll come on to some of the contact that I've had this week. There are people out there who are concerned that the register and the regime could potentially be a barrier to
Mr. Findlay.
On that point about the fears, and given Mr. Patterson's comment, is he quaking in his boots at the prospect of having to shred his Christmas card list, his letter to Santa, or his note for the Easter Bunny?
Minister?
Obviously, I'm not at all concerned. This bill doesn't place any onus on members. That was something that the committee's recommended. Now, the committee did consider the other option, which would be similar to the way that ministers record our meetings and engagements, that members could record their meetings and engagements, and that would put the onus on members. However, the committee's recommendation, although the convener did pilot such a regime and showed that it was... One second. The convener did pilot such a regime and showed that it was possible. However, that said, the committee as a whole concluded that that was not the best way forward, and we have tried to respond to the committee's deliberations.
Chuck Brodie.
Thank you for taking the intervention. Of course, all of us maintain a calendar of our events, and some of us actually make it public. I wonder why, in your opinion, the committee did not consider making that facility available for ministers and MSPs.
As I said, that mechanism is already in place for ministers, and meetings that ministers have are published. So the meetings I've had this week in relation to this bill will be published, and the meetings I've had in the past will be published. But I guess the of course.
Stevenson.
The minister quite correctly made reference to my publishing what, in my opinion, are interactions with me that are lobbying. But I think the committee very clearly took the view that for the onus of deciding what was lobbying to be placed on the person who's lobbied rather than the people who initiate the lobbying could be to transfer responsibility to the wrong people. So though my experience shows it's perfectly technically possible, there are severe risks that we would both miss things or over-report things because we aren't the ones doing the lobbying.
Minister.
So I think the convener obviously is able to articulate the reasonings behind the committee's deliberations better than I can. But as I said, our starting point was to look at what the committee's conclusions were and take them forward. Elaine Murray and Neil Finlay both referred, and I think there was maybe other references, to the suggestion, and there's again been some communications in this matter, that financial details should be provided. And of course, the bill as drafted does provide the Parliament with the powers to require that information. So that would be something that as the Parliament looks at the detailed operation of the bill, that they could make that the Parliament can make that choice, and that's something I'll come back to in terms of the powers that this bill gives to the Parliament. Obviously, there's a number of members who referred to other forms of lobbying, and also to advisers and civil servants. These are two areas where there has been a large amount of discussion, and I think we've all been in receipt of a number of representations on both sides. On one side, from people who are clear that this information is required, and on the other side, from groups and organisations who feel that this would provide a barrier to their engagement with the Parliament. And I think that's why it is very important that if we are going to make any changes around that, that we consider that very carefully, that we aren't bringing in a regime which will potentially be a barrier to that engagement. And that's engagement which Fiona McLeod referenced in her speech as being one of the founding principles. And she talked about how that was right from the very start of this Parliament, the ability for Civic Scotland to engage with this Parliament as being so very, very important. It was a theme which was extended by George Adam and I think Elaine Murray, in terms of needing to make sure that when the bill is finally passed at stage three, that we are protecting the constituency, the MSP constituency work that we do, and that we haven't inadvertently put in something in place that provides a barrier for that. And that does chime very much, well, she's not here, the points made by Patricia Ferguson in committee, that we need to make sure that what we are requiring registration of is lobbying and not engagement, which we would see as part of our day-to-day engagement. So I think that's a really important point. Any lobbying regime must not inhibit that legitimate engagement, and I'll continue to look carefully at the bill in this area to make sure, and we will make any necessary changes to protect those relationships. I'm very pleased that across the chamber, members have acknowledged the positive and important part lobbying plays in democracy and policy development, and I know that the people who engage with Parliament will be very pleased to hear that, and that we actually do respect that. And right across the chamber, I think from coming from all sides, people recognise that lobbying plays an important part in democracy and policy development. The convener was absolutely right when he said the aim of this bill is to helpfully put that legitimate activity in the public domain. I mentioned in my opening remarks that I had received a number of representations from stakeholders, and I know other members have as well, and I've also met with various stakeholders throughout the development of the bill. Not only does
One moment, Minister. There's an awful lot of noise from people who are just coming into the chamber. It would be a courtesy to the Minister and to those who have been taking part in the debate if you would just sit quietly and listen to it, Minister.
Not only does that typify the reputation of this Parliament has for engagement, but I hope it's a clear indication that I'm listening to different views in order to achieve broad support, not only within the Parliament, but outwith. One of the underpinning principles that I will continue to be guided by. I think it's important to touch on some of those points that the stakeholders have raised. Firstly, I think it is most important. Most people agree that the establishment of a lobbying register is a positive step in increasing transparency, and I think that's something that we should hold on to. So I think that's been important. I do acknowledge the recent poll undertaken by the Scottish Alliance for Lobbying Transparency, as mentioned by Cara Hilton, and that not only highlighted the public support for a lobbying register, but it contributed to the Transparency Group's campaign. The vibrancy of that kind of debate and campaign is very important to this Parliament and to Scottish democracy. I recognise the important points also made by the lobbying industry about ensuring there is a level playing field, and the Government has sought to introduce a bill that is simple in its understanding and operation. The voluntary sector have rightly highlighted the need to avoid any potential unnecessary burden on small organisations, a point reflected on by Gil Paterson in relation to some of the women's organisations in his constituency. And the business community have been clear that engagement with elected members is an important part of the process of policy development, and I agree that engagement is important, whether that be with business or with our constituents. Presiding Officer, when I opened the debate, I highlighted that the Lobbying Scotland Bill is an unusual bill being brought forward by the Government, yet very parliamentary in nature. That's why I've been keen from the outset to work closely with the Parliament, and this debate has certainly contributed to that aim. As the bill continues through the parliamentary passage, I hope that collaborative working will continue. Now, thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on stage one of the Lobbying Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of motion number 15213 in the name of John Swinney on the Lobbying Scotland Bill. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move the motion.
Moved.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 15221 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the Scottish Election Dates Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15220 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the Lobbying Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15213 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Lobbying Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. I am reliably informed that today is another first for the Parliament. This is, I understand, the first time one minister has been responsible for two separate pieces of legislation in the same sitting. So, on that note, it concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.